All right.
I don't want to work. I want to bang on the drum all day.
That's enough.
Everybody's working for the weekend.
I'm bringing the party to you.
Five.
It's Monday, Friday. I'm free again.
Four.
We're on a mission from God.
The Catholic Morning Show on Iowa Catholic Radio.
Good morning. I'm here.
With John Leonetti.
That broadcast school has really paid off.
Deacon Mark Campbell.
Yeah!
Mark Amadeo.
Ooh, yeah!
And Deacon Tony Valdez.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome into One and All. John Leonetti here on the Catholic Morning Show. It's Friday, April 26th. We made it. We've got a great show in store for you today. Coming up second half hour, Tom Chapman's going to be on. We have the legislative roundup. Tom comes on, I'd say, about once a quarter and gives us kind of an update of what's happening down there in the legislation. And Tom, of course, represents all four bishops for the state of Iowa. We're going to talk about the Religious Freedom Restoration Act today as well, something I know they've been really working on. He'll have a lot to say to it, so we'll have that for you coming up. No Father Andrew Winschittle. We're still praying for him, though. He took a fall, remember, a couple weeks ago, and so he's recovering. But he has been sending over notes for every Friday for the gospel for this Sunday. So I'll kind of read them a little bit. It's like the segment was written for me here. It's beautiful. So I'll read those a little bit here, and then we'll go into it here in this first half hour. After that, we're going to talk about the most powerful tool the devil uses. This is according to one priest. And how can we defeat this powerful tool? I'm not going to give it away yet, but we'll have that for you coming up at about 7:15 today. All right. No Deacon Tony. Let's offer a day to our Lord. And as we pray, God, our Father, we offer you our day. We offer you all of our thoughts, words, joys, and sufferings in union with the heart of Jesus. Holy Spirit, be our guide and strength today so that we may witness to your love. Mary, Mother of Jesus and the Church, pray for us. Amen. Let's go to Matt Willkom now, in for Mark Campbell.
Thank you, John. News brought to you this morning by Farm Bureau agent Cindy Schulte. Learn more at cindyschulte.com. Good morning. I'm Matt Willkom, sitting in for Deacon Mark Campbell. A $32 million indoor aquatic center covering nearly 40,000 square feet in Ames is expected to be ready for use by the end of 2025. The modern facility, which will include a lazy river, a water slide, and three warm water basins, will be located at 115 North Elm Avenue near the intersection of Lincoln Way and Grand Avenue. The single-story Fitch Family Indoor Aquatic Center will also provide year-round swimming lessons, exercise classes, water walking, lap swimming, open recreation, and additional exercise opportunities. Ames Director of Parks and Recreation Keith Abraham said the basic structure of the aquatic center should be erected by summer. This Sunday, Pope Francis will celebrate Mass in St. Mark's Square during a one-day trip to Venice, Italy. Afterward, he will privately venerate the relics of St. Mark the Evangelist inside the Basilica. This papal visit to the iconic Basilica puts a spotlight on the famous church dedicated to St. Mark on its significance to the famous floating city. The Holy Father's schedule includes meetings with inmates at a women's prison, a tour of the Vatican art exhibit on display there, a meeting with the featured artists, and a speech to young people. Lolo Jones is back at the Drake Relays, racing at her hometown track for the first time since 2014. The 41-year-old is one of the most celebrated athletes in the history of the relays and is now enshrined in the Hall of Fame. Jones, along with Augustana coach Tracy Hellman and high jumper Derek Druin, were inducted Thursday as the newest members of the Relays Hall of Fame class. After two Summer Olympics and a Winter Olympics in the bobsled in 2014, Jones is chasing the dream again. Her fastest time this season in the 100-meter hurdles is 13.11 seconds. She needs a 12.95 to qualify for the upcoming trials in Eugene, Oregon. Jones races the 100-meter hurdles Saturday at 2:55 p.m. Central. And now for your scoreboard update with Mark Amadeo.
In sports on your Friday morning, yesterday's Major League Baseball scoreboard, some of the Midwest teams were in action on Thursday. In interleague play, the Cubs pick up a win at home as they defeated the Houston Astros by the score of 3-1 at Wrigley Field in Chicago. The Cubs sweep the series over the Astros 3-0. In the National League, the St. Louis Cardinals had the day off on Thursday. The Cardinals open up a 3-game series at the New York Mets beginning tonight at 6 o'clock. The Milwaukee Brewers defeated the Pittsburgh Pirates by the score of 7-5 yesterday in Pittsburgh. In the American League in Minneapolis, the Minnesota Twins defeated the Chicago White Sox by the score of 6-3. And in Kansas City, the Royals defeated the Toronto Blue Jays by the score of 2-1 in 5 innings as that game was shortened due to rain. Last night, AAA baseball, the Iowa Cubs on the road at the Buffalo Bison, and it was a doubleheader played yesterday, Buffalo winning both games. Game one, it was Buffalo defeating the Iowa Cubs by the score of 5-3, and the Bison take the nightcap by the score of 10-3. Tonight, the Iowa Cubs at Buffalo, first pitch at 5 o'clock in Buffalo, New York. Last night, the NBA playoffs continued with first-round playoff games. These were all game three of a best-of-seven series. In the Eastern Conference in Orlando, the Magic defeated the Cleveland Cavaliers 121-83. Cleveland leads that best-of-seven series 2-1. The other Eastern Conference game had the Philadelphia 76ers defeating the New York Knicks by the score of 125-114 in Philadelphia. The Knicks lead that best-of-seven series 2-1. And in the Western Conference playoff, the Denver Nuggets defeated the Los Angeles Lakers 112-105 in Los Angeles. Denver leads that best-of-seven series 3-0. And with your Friday morning sports update on the Catholic Morning Show, I'm Mark Amadeo.
Thank you, Mark. And now let's go to Brady with your forecast.
Thank you, Matt. Good morning, everyone. Weather today is brought to you by Skeffington's Formal Wear. You can learn more at skeffingtons.com. For today, we're looking at those showers and thunderstorms and breezy conditions and highs in the mid-60s. Your chance of rain's at 90%. For tonight, showers and thunderstorms are likely. Some thunderstorms may be severe in the evening. Chance of rain at 80%. And then on your Saturday, partly sunny skies with a slight chance of showers and thunderstorms. Storms and highs in the upper 70s. Current temperatures, Des Moines sitting at 54, Ames and Marshalltown 46, and Fairfield 48 degrees. Back to you, John.
Jesus says in the gospel for this Sunday, John 15 is what we're looking at. He said, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He takes away every branch in me that does not bear fruit, and every one that does, he prunes so that it bears fruit. More fruit. You are already pruned because of the word that I spoke to you. Remain in me as I remain in you." Jesus, of course, helps us understand here who is the vine. And that is God within our lives. Father Andrew sent over a few notes for us to reflect on this morning as he continues to recover. He says, the vine imagery Jesus uses here isn't new. It's used in the Old Testament to symbolize Israel. So, of course, we have the church, and, you know, here is the fulfillment of it all, right? Right within the one holy Catholic and apostolic church. Israel, the people of God, God's chosen people here. Right? God uses this same imagery for them in the Old Testament. We see in the Old Testament how Israel often came up short in carrying out God's plan. And we do so as well every time we sin. Father Andrew goes on to say, because he's also divine, he's the only human who can and does perfectly fulfill that plan. So God stands in for every one of us what we would truly deserve. And that is the rejection of him, right? We have rejected God. We said no to God. Kind of reviewing a little bit, you know, you may say, well, I didn't say no to God, right? No, you did. It's the universal no, that the universal decision that our parents, Adam and Eve, made, and we continue to make every time we sin. It's another no to God and what God's plan is for us. God is the only one taking on human that can restore that relationship with us perfectly. And so he does not consider what we deserve, but he stands in for what we would deserve, dying for us. But we're still not off the hook, Father says, because God expects us to bear fruit now. In other words, to do good works with the grace that he offers us. So you may think, well, okay, I know the right answer, right? Or you may say, I know the truth, but that's not enough. It's not enough. Now we bear fruit. This is a command from the Lord. The Lord doesn't give us any wiggle room here, right? He says, you know, now, just as a branch cannot bear fruit on its own unless it remains in the vine, so neither can you unless you remain in me. And he sends us out now to go and bear fruit. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask for whatever you want and it will be done for you. By this is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples, that you bear much fruit. So Jesus says, don't sit idly here, right? He says the same thing to us today. Don't sit idly, right? In the comforts of kind of your own boat, if you will, for an analogy, right? We just kind of sit in that boat oftentimes and just kind of, take whatever comes to us in that day. Sometimes it's a little rocky and windy. Sometimes a storm brews. And sometimes it's just real peaceful waters, right? But the Lord says, no, don't just stay in your boat. Get out. Get out of your boat. Now go spread the word. Do good news. Do good works. For me and my kingdom. And if you know me, you're going to. You can't help it. And this is really important, I think. Because, again, this is God's grace. And Father Andrew says it perfectly here, right? This is God's grace that he offers us. All we have to do is tap into it and to go out. Father Andrew goes on to say the primary way we do that as Christians is by remaining in him, Jesus, as branches to the vine, especially by partaking of his body, blood, soul, and divinity in the Eucharist. It's no mistake that this passage is in the context of the Last Supper, he says. You know, there's kind of a recipe, at least I see, for holiness. It looking out into all of our saints, and that's who we look to, right? They knew the Lord, and they never wavered in their prayer life. Prayer was never an option for them. They really went all in on the graces of the Eucharist and the graces of confession, the graces of the sacraments, right? I mean, daily communicants, daily mass for most of these saints, if they could. Confession, at least weekly, Mother Teresa every other day. Many of the other saints every week, right? Many of the other saints that we read about. And then they didn't sit idle. They went out and said, all right, Lord, now you can do the work. But they remained on the vine. And that is the prayer that they had. So all three go hand in hand. You can't have one really without the other. You just can't in the Christian world. You know, that's what God gives us. Prayer. This is what roots us. It keeps us rooted in Christ. So the Holy Spirit can speak through us. The sacraments, we stay engaged in the spiritual life of the church and what God offers us, right? Remaining one with his body. We can't separate from that. We don't do good works apart from Christ. We have Christ the head. We have the church as the body. So we remain in the church with Christ the head, feeding us the graces that he gives us through the sacramental life. And then, of course, we can't sit idle in this. We got to make a decision and say, okay, I'm going to go. I'm going to go to my workplace today, a new person. I'm going to go into my workplace today, a Christ follower. That's my identity now. You know, I'm going to go into the grocery store today. I'm going to go in with the patience of someone that follows Jesus. With my kids. Boy, that's heroic. Right? Patience with the kids. In my marriage. Whatever the case. I'm going to do so now, clothed with Jesus Christ, staying rooted to the vine. So good stuff this morning. A little reflection for this Sunday's Mass. Thanks to Father Andrew. I hope he's listening right now. We're praying for you, Father. All right, coming up right after this, a priest explains the most powerful tool of the devil. And how do we defeat that tool? We'll have that for you right when we come back. Don't go anywhere. John Linetti here on the Catholic Morning Show.
You're listening to the Catholic Morning Show on Iowa Catholic Radio.
From Norwalk to Pleasantville and everywhere at iowacatholicradio.com or the Iowa Catholic Radio app. Listener-supported Iowa Catholic Radio, connecting listeners to Christ.
Support for Iowa Catholic Radio provided by Farm Bureau agent Cindy Schulte, an authorized independent agent for Walmart Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Iowa, an independent licensee of the Blue Cross Blue Shield Association. Learn more at 515-226-2111 or cindyschulte.com.
Iowa Catholic Radio would like to thank our business partner, Edible Arrangements, for their support, offering fruit bouquets and gourmet-dipped chocolate treats. On the go or have it delivered for that special occasion, EdibleArrangements.com.
Support for Iowa Catholic Radio is provided by Paul Martin and Paul Mitchell, owners of Imogene Ingredients. Imogene Ingredients supply specialized feed ingredients for livestock and pet diets to improve maternal and young animal health in both conventional and organic production.
Support for Iowa Catholic Radio comes from the Des Moines Symphony hosting an evening with Renee Elise Goldsberry, who took Broadway by storm when she originated the role of Angelica in the blockbuster musical Hamilton. This powerhouse vocalist sings Broadway hits alongside the orchestra in a one-night-only performance. With her Tony Award for Best Featured Actress and a Grammy for Cast Recording, she returns to Des Moines Saturday, April 27th at the Civic Center. Learn more at dmsymphony.org.
Friends, Roman Catholics, lend me your books.
Here you go.
The Iowa Catholic Radio
Lending Library. Look, there's theology, spirituality, church history, even CDs and DVDs.
And if there's a book interview we did that piqued your interest, chances are we've got it.
Shall I compare thee to a summer's day?
You know you can't take the entire library home.
Oh, parting is such sweet sorrow.
Methinks thou dost protest too much.
Touché.
Visit the Iowa Catholic Radio Lending Library in West Des Moines.
Support for programming provided by Modus Maryland, offering a wide selection of clothing for a baptism, First Communion, quinceañera, wedding, or any special occasion, as well as accessories and jewelry, 4120 Southeast 14th Street in Des Moines, and online, modusmaryland.com.
Support for Iowa Catholic Radio comes from Westgate Dental, offering cosmetic, family, implant, and general dentistry. Located at 1073rd Street, Suite 1 in West Des Moines, just behind Dowling Catholic High School. Learn more at westgatedentalia.com.
Throughout history, our Lord has shown us that He is truly present in the Blessed Sacrament. Experience these wonders for yourself as Iowa Catholic Radio presents the Vatican International Exhibition, Eucharistic Miracles of the World, at St. Joseph Catholic Church in Milford, Iowa, now through May 15th. Learn more about how you can bring this beautiful panel display to your parish, school, or faith-based organization by calling 515-223-1150 or visit iowacatholicradio.com.
The Catholic Morning Show on Iowa Catholic Radio.
All the devil desires to do is instill fear. Father Bill Peckman put together a really nice blog piece, and just kind of touch on it for a couple minutes here. He says fear, that's the tool, the gravest tool, the most powerful tool that the devil has against us. Not the fear of the Lord that he talks about. That's, what God gives to us, a spiritual gift, right? A respect or wonder, awe of God. The fear, Father Bill says, which tells us that God does not want what is good for us. So it's the original fear, right, of Adam and Eve, where God says, whoa, 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 what did he tell you? Oh, okay. I told you that. Well, I know there's fruit and veggies and all the other trees, but this one right here, he doesn't want you to eat from it. That's because it's the tree of knowledge. And he knows that if you eat from that tree, you're going to become smart like him, and God doesn't want the competition. So go ahead, eat from the tree, become smart. Now, ironically, they ate from the tree and became smart enough to know they made a terrible decision. But you get the point here, right? God, or the devil right away tries to pit us against God. God doesn't want what's good for you. Oh, he said, don't do that? Well, obviously, it's because he's a threat. I mean, you see this all the time, you know, in our culture today, right? I'm free. You do you. It's not about, you know, any kind of rules. All the Catholic Church, you have so many rules in the faith, right? When you're good parents, know you got to have rules, good rules, a handful of rules, if you will, if you're going to have well-behaved children. And so God gives us a church to be able to help establish that, of course, what holiness looks like and what is in our lives. But you see here the fear, right? The fear of what if God doesn't really want what's good for me? What if I just, you know what's better for me? You know, can I just follow what I want rather than what God wants? It's more fun. It's easier. More comfortable. Right? Fear is what destroys us. And Father Bill talks about, he says, fear destroys evangelization, our ability to go out and evangelize. Fear destroys, he says, in a lot of ways, it can destroy our vocations. So even those discerning vocations, fearful. I was talking to someone the other day out of state here, and she was talking about how she really believes she might be called to the religious life, but she's scared. She's fearful. She was an older woman. And she said, I've been single my whole life, and I feel like I might be called here. And I said, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. It destroys. And Jesus says it 365 times. Do not be afraid. So what's the remedy here? The remedy is fortitude, Father Bill says. Yes, one decision at a time, one virtue at a time. That's infused. It needs to be infused, at least within us. Faith, hope, and love. Everything else is going to stem from that. How do we battle it? We just go right back to the source, right back to the well, the theological virtues. Lord, give me faith. Lord, help me to hope in you. Lord, increase my charity, my love. Do not be afraid. All right, let's go to our next guest. She is author of the book When Jesus Speaks for Children, Susan Joy Bellavance. Am I getting the last name right?
Bellavance.
Bellavance. Yes, very good, Susan. All right. When Jesus Speaks. I like it. First of all, I mean, the art on the cover looks amazing. Doesn't look like a children's book.
It is actually, okay, I'll give you a secret to my life. That's my seventh book. I don't write for children. I write children's books for adults.
Nice.
Because, you know, you're going to have to read it to your kid. So I set it up so that you read this book and you have a conversion. So I shouldn't let people know my secret, but there you go.
I like it. Get a little bit closer to the receiver if you could, because we're having a little trouble hearing you here. Tell me about the book, When Jesus Speaks.
When Jesus Speaks is a Catholic apologetic book that will singe whoever's fingers holding it. There are very few words, and it was conceived, I don't know, over a lifetime of prayer, really. And I have a special love for the Blessed Sacrament, as every Catholic should. But it mystifies me that a person can read the Bible, love Jesus, I use the Word of God, and yet when Jesus says something, nobody believes it. Hmm. So the book shows you. He says to the leper, be cleansed, and you turn the page. And he was. He says to the blind man, you know, receive your sight, turn the page. And he did. And it's gorgeous art. Byron Hamilton is a super artist. And we go through all the miracles. And then we get to the middle of the book, wind and the waves. And they were. The bread and the wine. This is my body. This is my blood. And you turn the page and it goes, and it was. And then you turn the page and he says, do this in memory of me. And you turn it and it goes, and they did. And there's Peter saying Mass. And they did. There's St. Patrick in Ireland. And they did. Andrew Kim, Augustus Tolson, John Paul II. And my pastor is on the last page.
I like it.
And it says, my word will go out from my mouth and will not return to me until it has done what I said, sent it to do. Now, do you think he was kidding when he said that? I can't conceive the lack of faith in the Blessed Sacrament. I can't understand it. Don't tell me you have Jesus. But when he says in John 6:53, I tell you most solemnly, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you will not have life in you. Do you think he was kidding? And when he says something, I tell you most solemnly, do you think you should sit up and listen? So this book is so simple, so beautiful. Even if you stand in the bookstore and read it, it's going to afflict you by the time you get to the last page because you know it's true.
Why did you choose to write so simply, right, with just very few words? Because it's a really interesting route to go.
Yeah, because people are meme. We're a meme-aholic.
Yeah.
You know, and I want to give you my message. I'm going to give you my message in about 4 minutes. And you know, it's going to be done so unforgettably and so succinctly, it's going to scorch you in your soul. And you won't, you will not, after you look at this book, you won't be able to unlook at it, because it'll be in your mind. And my point with this is, yes, we are in a mean culture, and where people don't read. So I'm trying to catch with a big net children and parents, families, and in just one brief moment, you can have an experience of the truth of the gospel that's going to be written. I have this understanding: when you have really good art and you have good words, it creates a third thing, and it goes into your soul. Mm. So that's a firm belief that I have. I really, I'm very strong on needing really good art in order to convey spiritual truth. Because if you make Jesus a cartoon, then he's going to take him serious. And when we were kids, you know, you had your Baltimore Catechism. Those pictures in there, even as a little kid, those pictures affected me, and they stay with you. So this book, it takes very art very serious, it takes the word very serious, and it takes Catholic tradition very serious. You can't do anything more than this book does with a children's book.
Well, you're on fire, Susan. My goodness.
Yeah, man. Oh, yeah.
Wow.
I love my face.
I can hear that.
And I'm expecting, with this, I'm expecting great things. I raised the money for the artwork myself. I pitched the book first, and nobody wanted it, because when you send in your little bit of words, they're like, what the heck is this?
Yeah.
But so then I went and I said, I know this book is right. And, you know, you feel something in your bones, and you just got to go with it. So I raised some money myself, and I scraped together money. A priest friend gave me some money, and that's all our person. And I paid my artist myself.
Wow.
And I said, now do you want the book? And they're like, oh, yeah, this is a great book.
Yeah, I can see that. That can happen.
So first of three books, and This Little Light of Thine is the one that comes after it, and it's about the sanctuary candle, and the last one is about Come and See, and that's about adoration. So I'm gonna draw you in. I'm going to draw you to the tabernacle by the time I get done with you. So the second book I've already written, and now I'm just trying to carve together money to get my artist to be able to do the next book.
Well, the art is absolutely beautiful. I mean, there's no question about that. I mean, what you put together here is really awesome. You can go to sophiainstitute.com. You can get the book there, When Jesus Speaks. You can also go to Divine Treasures locally here. If they don't have it, they will certainly order it for you. Her name is Susan Bellavance. Thank you, Susan, for coming on your work.
You're so welcome. God bless you for your work. I love it.
Thank you. You as well. All right, Susan Bellavance, everyone. Good stuff. Yeah, I like that. There's grit there, right? And Susan, she's saying, hey, if you're not going to pick this up, I'm going to go do all the heavy lifting now. I like that, right? That's how you get things done. Lord, help me, and I'm going to go. Tom Chapman coming up, second half hour. We're going to talk about the legislative roundup that has happened and the Religious Freedom Restoration Act. We'll have all the updates on that. Of course, Tom, remember, represents the four bishops for the state of Iowa. So he is always advocating on Capitol Hill for them and the Holy Catholic Church right here in the great state of Iowa. Tom will give us all the updates as they wrap up this legislative session. Let's go right now to Father Smith with today's gospel and reflection.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God. Have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way." Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Hi, this is Father Nick Smith, parochial vicar of Christ the King Parish in Des Moines. Jesus gives us a very difficult commandment in the very first line of the Gospel today. Do not let your hearts be troubled. how consoling this line is, and yet how difficult it is to live out. Life is filled with many cares and preoccupations and anxieties that we carry with us day to day, minute to minute. And yet the Lord asks us this simple thing: do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God, have faith also in me. From all eternity I have prepared a dwelling place for you in my kingdom. And if you remain faithful, if you continue to serve me, if you continue to follow after me, I will show you that place. Do not let your heart be troubled. When you don't know the way, speak Jesus. When you don't know what to say, speak Jesus. And when life seems to be passing away, speak Jesus. He is the way and the truth and the life, and we must always follow after him. May God bless you, and let us continue praying for each other.
Confluence Brewing Company, a former homebrewer's dream, is now a hub where great things come together. Situated south of Gray's Lake and easily accessible via the bike trail in Des Moines. Thank you, Confluence Brewing Company, for your support of Iowa Catholic Radio.
Support for Iowa Catholic Radio comes from Next Generation Realty, a Catholic and family-owned flat-fee brokerage serving central Iowa since 1994. Next Generation Realty can handle every step of the process of buying or selling a home. Learn more at nextgenerationrealty.com.
Support for Iowa Catholic Radio is provided by the Sarah Vocations Ministry, including the St. Sarah Club of Des Moines and the Sarah Club of Council Bluffs. Sarah is an apostolate of the Worldwide Catholic Church dedicated to fostering and supporting priesthood and religious vocations. Sarahs strive to accomplish their mission through prayer, fellowship, and service to the bishop, priests, sisters, and all in religious formation, and in doing so to increase their own holiness. Learn more at joinserra.org, joinserra.org. Thank you, Sarahs, for your support of Iowa Catholic Radio.
St. Joseph's in Des Moines is hosting their second annual World Food Festival, Sunday, May 5th from 4:30 to 6 p.m. Food samples representing the diverse heritage of the parish community will be available. Sales support Teen Ministry, 2107 East 33rd Street. A message from Iowa Catholic Radio.
The Catholic Morning Show on Iowa Catholic Radio.
Thanks for tuning in, everybody. Coming up, Tom Chapman's going to be on. Represents the bishops of the state of Iowa down at the legislative branch, and down there at Capitol Hill, we're going to talk about kind of the Religious Freedom Restoration Act and things that have kind of wrapped up as well. We'll kind of comb over the session, do a little inventory of what's been going on and what's the priorities for the bishops moving forward here. It's always good to have Tom on. About once a quarter, he comes on to be able to help us walk through everything. So I always appreciate it. All right. No Deacon Tony. Let's instead pray our morning offering as we pray. God, our Father, we offer you our day. We offer you all of our thoughts, all of our words, joys, and sufferings in union with the heart of Jesus. Holy Spirit, be our guide and our strength today so that we may witness to your love. Mary, Mother of Jesus and the Church, pray for us. Amen. Let's go to Matt Willkom now in for Deacon Mark.
Thank you, John. News brought to you this morning by Farm Bureau agent Cindy Schulte. Learn more at cindyschulte.com. Good morning. I'm Matt Willkom, sitting in for Deacon Mark Campbell. The Iowa Department of Natural Resources is investigating sewer discharge running into Gator Creek. Des Moines City officials notified Iowa DNR of a sanitary sewer overflow near Southeast 14th Street and East Deal Avenue. Yater Creek runs from Upper East Lake to Fleur Drive near the Des Moines International Airport. Raw sewage reportedly made its way along East Deal Avenue, where it entered a storm sewer which discharges into the creek. Iowa DNR urges downstream users to exercise caution and avoid the creek. At this time, there are no reports of dead fish. 85 hours and 42 minutes. That was the time it took students, faculty, monks, and staff to read the Bible from beginning to end at Belmont Abbey College in North Carolina during its first ever cover-to-cover Bible marathon reading event earlier this month. More than 110 readers took turns standing at a podium in the college's main administration building, reading aloud from sacred scripture throughout the day and night, beginning Monday, April 8th, and ending in the early hours of Friday, April 12th. Tom McAllister, the Vice Provost and Dean of Student Life, said the idea was an easy sell to students who could sign up for a time that worked with their class schedules, adding, quote, "If we're looking for a guide, if we're looking for inspiration in how to live a holy life and one day hopefully get to heaven and bring our friends, we can't be ignorant of Scripture." There are now plans in the works to ensure each incoming class to Belmont Abbey has the opportunity to take part in the Bible Marathon at least once during their 4 years at the college. Lolo Jones is back at the Drake Relays, racing at her hometown track for the first time since 2014. The 41-year-old is one of the most celebrated athletes in the history of the relays and is now enshrined in the Hall of Fame. Jones, along with Augustana coach Tracy Hellman and high jumper Derek Druin, were inducted Thursday as the newest members of the Relays Hall of Fame class. After two Summer Olympics and a Winter Olympics in the bobsled in 2014, Jones is chasing the dream again. Her fastest time this season in the 100-meter hurdles is 13.11 seconds. She needs a 12.95 to qualify for the upcoming trials in Eugene, Oregon. Jones races the 100-meter hurdles Saturday at 2:55 p.m. Central. And now for your scoreboard update with Mark Amadeo.
In sports on your Friday morning, yesterday's Major League Baseball scoreboard. Some of the Midwest teams were in action on Thursday. In interleague play, the Cubs pick up a win at home as they defeated the Houston Astros by the score of 3-1 at Wrigley Field in Chicago. The Cubs sweep the series over the Astros 3-0. In the National League, the St. Louis Cardinals had the day off on Thursday. The Cardinals open up a 3-game series at the New York Mets beginning tonight at 6 o'clock. The Milwaukee Brewers defeated the Pittsburgh Pirates by the score of 7-5 yesterday in Pittsburgh. In the American League in Minneapolis, the Minnesota Twins defeated the Chicago White Sox by the score of 6-3. And in Kansas City, the Royals defeated the Toronto Blue Jays by the score of 2-1 in 5 innings as that game was shortened due to rain. Last night, AAA baseball, the Iowa Cubs on the road at the Buffalo Bison, and it was a doubleheader played yesterday, Buffalo winning both games. Game one, it was Buffalo defeating the Iowa Cubs by the score of 5-3, and the Bison take the nightcap by the score of 10-3. Tonight, the Iowa Cubs at Buffalo, first pitch at 5 o'clock in Buffalo, New York. Last night, the NBA playoffs continued with first-round playoff games. These were all Game 3 of a best-of-seven series. In the Eastern Conference in Orlando, the Magic defeated the Cleveland Cavaliers 121-83. Cleveland leads that best-of-seven series 2-1. The other Eastern Conference game had the Philadelphia 76ers defeating the New York Knicks by the score of 125-114 in Philadelphia. The Knicks lead that best-of-seven series 2-1. And in the Western Conference playoff, the Denver Nuggets defeated the Los Angeles Lakers 112-105 in Los Angeles. Denver leads that best-of-seven series 3-0. And with your Friday morning sports update on the Catholic Morning Show, I'm Mark Amadeo.
Thank you, Mark. And now let's go to Brady with your wet forecast.
That's correct, Matt. We are looking at rainy conditions today. Weather today is brought to you by Skeffington's Formal Wear. You can learn more at skeffingtons.com. For today, those showers and thunderstorms, breezy conditions and highs in the mid-60s. For tonight, showers and thunderstorms are likely. Some thunderstorms may be severe in the evening with a chance of rain at 80%. And then on your Saturday, partly sunny skies, chance of showers and thunderstorms sitting at 50% for Saturday, and highs in the upper 70s. Currently, Des Moines at 50 degrees, Ames and Marshalltown 47, and Fairfield 48 degrees. Back to you, John.
Thank you, Brady. Let's go to your saint of the day.
This is your saint of the day on Iowa Catholic Radio.
He was Central America's first canonized saint, and more than 500,000 people were present for his canonization ceremony. Saint Pedro de San Jose Betancourt was born in the small Canary Islands off the coast of Africa, and as a young man traveled to Guatemala. He arrived so destitute that he joined a bread line organized by the Franciscans. Pedro had a strong desire to spread the gospel and wanted to be a priest, but he did not have the necessary schooling for the job. Instead, Pedro first joined the secular Franciscans and later created the Brothers and Sisters of Bethlehem. Pedro built a hospital for the poor in Guatemala City, a homeless shelter, and a Catholic school for the impoverished. All this Pedro completed quite quickly. He died of pneumonia at the age of 41. He was canonized a saint 350 years later by Pope St. John Paul II. We ask today, St. Pedro de San Jose Betancourt, to pray for us. Amen. Let's go to Gene Till right now, talking about making it personal with Bishop William Joensen. Good morning, Gene.
Hey, John. How you doing?
Doing fine. What do we got coming up on the show?
Well, we have a special guest, Father Donald Haggerty. And Bishop really enjoys his reading, his materials, and was very much looking forward to interviewing him. I think he's one of his favorite authors. So, nice. Very cool. And Father Haggerty is at St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York City. But he is a prolific author, and we talk specifically about his book, Conversion, Spiritual Insights into an Essential Encounter with God. So that's kind of the premise, but, you know, it was a great conversation with him, you know, about what's happening at St. Patrick's and really this relationship with God. It was good.
That's cool.
So, yeah.
And when is that going to be on the show?
Tomorrow morning, Saturday morning, 8 a.m., and then Sunday at 11 a.m.
Saturday mornings at 8 a.m., Sundays at 11 a.m. is when you can find the show, Making It Personal with Bishop Joensen and Gene Till. God bless you, Gene. Thanks for coming on.
You're welcome, John. Have a blessed weekend.
You as well. All right, Tom Chapman, when we come back on the Legislative Roundup, Tom represents the four bishops of the state of Iowa. We're going to talk specifically about the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, all when we come back. John Linetti here on the Catholic Morning Show. Friends, don't go anywhere.
You're listening to the Catholic Morning Show on Iowa Catholic Radio.
Here's your news from the Diocese of Des Moines this Friday, April 26th. I'm Anne Marie Cox. On Sunday, the second group of men to be ordained permanent deacons in our diocese will celebrate their 50th anniversary. Two deacons from that class are Deacons Leo Gall from Shelby County and Don Jacoby, who is in Cedar Rapids now. We thank them and all of our deacons for serving God's people through the Diaconate. A missionary image of Our Lady of Guadalupe will be at Saints John and Paul Parish in Altoona this Sunday. You can view it during the 8:30 and 10:30 Masses. We thank Our Lady of Guadalupe for her intercessions as we try to protect life in Iowa, and we ask for her continued intercession. That's your news from the Diocese of Des Moines. I'm Anne Marie Cox.
Support for programming is provided by Construction Professionals, serving customers through a proven process, creating unique design, functionality, and artistic beauty. Construction Professionals is a Catholic family business built on a strong foundation. CPCustomHomes.com.
Join Iowa Catholic Radio at our annual Golf Classic, Thursday, May 9th at Legacy Golf Club in Norwalk. Everyone will enjoy an unforgettable day of golf. To register your foursome or learn more about sponsorship opportunities, visit iowacatholicradio.com.
Support for Iowa Catholic Radio comes from Caldwell Parish Funeral Home and Crematory. Caldwell Parish offers services that are unique to the individual while following the Catholic funeral rites. Caldwell Parish Funeral Home and Crematory, Des Moines' only Catholic-owned and operated funeral home.
The Man Up West Power Lunch is May 10th at St. Francis of Assisi in West Des Moines. Dr. Bud Marr, co-host of The Uncommon Good, will speak about the Second Vatican Council and its influence on the new evangelization. Noon start time and lunch is provided by Chick-fil-A, iowacatholicradio.com.
At noon Monday through Friday, the doctor is in. Dr. Ray Guarendi helps you with personal problems and professional questions. You'll love his fun approach and practical advice. The doctor is in on the Iowa Catholic Radio Network. Connecting listeners to Christ.
The Catholic Morning Show on Iowa Catholic Radio.
Thanks for tuning in today, friends. Monday, we've got a great one in store for you. Eric Groth is going to be on. Eric is the CEO of Renovo Media Group, president of Outside the Box Films. And they have just put together some amazing films and short films, video catechism series as well, that they've been doing. Really just quality stuff. So we'll have Eric on. Really excited to catch up with him. Let's go to Tom Chapman. Tom represents the four bishops of the diocese on Capitol Hill. Hello, Tom.
Hello, John. How
Always
are you?
Good to have you, my friend. Yeah. And it has wrapped up, right? The legislative session?
Yeah, legislation is all done. They finished up about 4:30 on Saturday morning.
How does that happen?
Well, they try to pull an all-nighter. They want to get done for the weekend when they're finally done.
Really?
You know, last Tuesday, a week ago Tuesday, they stopped getting paid. So that's always an incentive
Oh, really?
To get done. So then they finished up Saturday morning and and just kind of pulled an all-nighter and got it done finally.
So everyone has to stay?
Oh, yeah. They need the votes. And so there's a couple people that may have other things they had to do. But other than that, everybody's there. So.
That's incredible. Yeah. I have not heard that. I don't know how things like this work, kind of the back channels. Are you there?
Yeah. Well, not every year would I be. This year I was because...
So 4:30?
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's just...
Really?
You got to keep an eye on things, especially if there's something that's still in play that you're interested in. So
what were you interested in?
Well, there was a bill that would put some mandates on Catholic schools. Not that it was a bad bill, but it was something that we thought should be done in a different way. I mean, we're trying to get the legislature to do some training for teachers on a rotating basis for different health needs, different diseases, so they know how to deal with students who have epilepsy, for example, things like that. But the legislature has a way of just trying to do, you know, one disease a year, you know, which gets to be quite a burden for the public schools.
They like the church. They move slow.
Yeah, they do. And so we're trying to get them to do it in a more planful way.
Yeah.
So I was kind of keeping an eye on that one in particular and just to see if there was any last minute things other than that.
So what have we accomplished for the Catholic Church? Do we have any wins in the last legislative session?
Yeah, I think, you know, I always look at it as a 2-year session because the General Assembly is 2 years. You know, last year they did pass the education savings account, which we'd worked on for many, many years. This year, another thing that we had worked on for many years is the Religious Freedom Restoration Act. We've been looking to have a state version of that federal law. You know, I think I started working on that in 2010. And obviously, it was a good group of people, Alliance Defending Freedom, the Family Leader, ourselves, First Amendment Partnership, all worked together on that and finally got across the finish line this year. So we're very excited about that. Basically, it means that government cannot burden someone's religious practice unless they have a really good reason.
Really?
And so it
in Iowa.
In Iowa specifically.
What do you mean by
state
burden?
Laws. Well, one example, and this is from Texas, actually a true example, is that there was a kindergarten child who was a Native American and wore long hair. And the school district rule said you have to cut the hair to a certain length. And the parents took that to court, and the state court in Texas said, no, we have a RFRA, a Religious Freedom Restoration Act, and that child is enabled to keep the hair at that length because that's part of their religious practice. So a lot of times it's little things like that for, I would say, minority religions. From our perspective, it actually helps keep things out of court. Because now there's a clear standard that the government would have to have a compelling interest to make someone impede their religious practice.
Has there been cases of that you've seen since 2010 that this will solve?
You know, I think a lot of people imagine it's about, to be honest, like issues with gay people and providing services to them. Most often we don't see that. Sometimes this was used in some states with the pandemic, where churches were not allowed to meet, other than, but they reopened casinos, but they wouldn't let churches meet, you know?
Yeah.
Now, fortunately in Iowa, we didn't have that problem with Governor Reynolds, but that's the type of thing hopefully it would solve.
Interesting stuff. Tom Chapman's with us right now. What's your official title?
Executive Director of the Iowa Catholic Conference.
Executive Director of the Iowa Catholic Conference. I just say you represent the bishops.
Yeah, no, and that's easier for people to understand.
So that is passed, a Religious Freedom
Restoration
Act.
Yeah, it's passed and signed by the governor, and so we're really pleased that that happened after a lot of work.
That, you know, I mean, that 2010, that's 14 years.
Yeah, you know, it's
really
just, sometimes it takes too long.
14 years?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
How?
Well, it, you know, so often, John, it starts with one little idea that one group is working on.
Okay.
And we started working on that with one other group who's actually no longer up in the Capitol and just started the conversation and got a bill introduced. And it was me and one other person versus 40 other people in a subcommittee hearing, and people were freaking out and all of that. So over time, you know, it just gets a little farther through one chamber, through a committee, gets a little more normalized until ultimately it passes, you know, when there's a lot more groups that come around to it. And so that's very common about how things happen at the legislature.
Give me some updates on the education savings account that's taken place.
Yeah, well, that application period is now open, so people just need to search for that. They can go to ESAs for Iowa website and take a look at that. It's open until June 30th.
Okay.
And so parents whose income is at 400% or less of the federal poverty level are eligible this year, or if you're coming over from a public school, or if you're starting out in kindergarten. Mm. So those groups basically are the ones who will qualify for this fall. And next year, that's only a one-year thing. Next year, all students will qualify.
Okay.
So we're very excited about that. And it's right now, it's about $7,600 that they will receive to help pay for tuition to a non-public school.
So if any person next year applies, wherever they go, whether that's Dowling Catholic or, you know, St. Pius,
right,
they get $7,600.
Yeah, $7,600 to go towards tuition.
Okay.
And so,
and if tuition is more than that, the rest is out of your pocket.
Yeah, that's out of your pocket. And tuition will go up a little bit, in fact, because of what the legislature is doing. They, once again, they raise the public teacher's salary, minimum salary, which is good, but it's going to go from $33,000 this year to $50,000 in 2 years.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
So it's not a bad business to get
in if
you want to be a teacher nowadays.
Boy, my mom's probably sitting back saying, what in the world,
what happened
man?
To me,
yeah.
Right? But obviously, and that flows through the system,
yeah.
You know, obviously, for teachers who have been there for a while. So it's a great opportunity to get some good people in the profession and get them interested. But it's going to cost more money.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just, that's how it works.
Migration legislation.
Yeah, we were disappointed the legislature passed a bill that has to do with state enforcement of federal immigration law. And so there are some events coming up on May 1st that some parishes and dioceses are publicizing, you know, to help people realize what's going on.
What is going on?
Well, basically, it creates a state crime of reentry. So if you've ever been received a removal, you know, from the government or came illegally, you don't have papers, it's now a state crime to be present in Iowa starting on July 1st, which we're very disappointed by that. And I think that will have impact on some people. It's no secret that there may be a court challenge to that bill. So we'll see if it actually goes into effect. But we were disappointed that the legislature passed that. One reason is, you know, let the federal government do its job. And then we go to the federal government and we say, do your job.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, provide a decent number of visas for people to come in the country and get things in order at the southern border. But there's a lot of fear over, you know, what we all see is happening at the southern border. And it's the federal government's job. And we support them in their job of regulating the border. So this bill was not a great thing from our perspective. And a lot of the Hispanic ministry and our Catholic Charities people are working to inform people about what their rights still will be. You know, part of the problem with it is that even if people have a court date to have their case adjudicated,
mm-hmm.
they still could be deported through this law.
Mm.
Even if they have that kind of status to have their case looked at. And so from our perspective, that's disappointing. We'll just have to see where that goes.
Iowa Moms.
Yeah, we were happy to see there were some tweaks made to the Iowa Moms program. And that program sends money to pregnancy counseling centers. So there are a few places this spring that already received some state funds. This should make it easier for other Iowa groups to apply. So we're very excited to get that rolling. We'd really like to see that money get out the door faster. And I know HHS is interested in trying to work on that. So that was a good tweak that we think happened. And the legislature also did another thing, which they extended Medicaid coverage for new moms. Mm. If you're on Medicaid, right now you get 2 months of coverage after the birth of the child, and that extends it to a year. Unfortunately, it was very complicated, but they lowered some of the eligibility and some of the women will go on to different programs. And so I would say it was a mixed bag, but still overall good that, you know, women who, at, you know, it's an important time after the child is born, and to have that coverage go to a year is a good thing.
So what do you do now?
Well, right now I'm getting ready for my board meeting.
Yeah.
And sneak preview, a little spoiler alert. I think the bishops may be coming out with a statement on this immigration law
mm-hmm.
next week. It's something that's kind of possibly in the works. We're certainly trying to educate people about that. And then this summer I'll be going to a meeting about education savings account and doing some presentations there. next month. And then there's a school leader summit and actually another meeting taking place at the border that I might be going to. So it'll be that kind of thing in the summer. And then in the fall, it will be meeting with legislators. It'll be election season. So we'll put out some materials on faithful citizenship, and that'll start coming out next month. And then I'll be doing presentations on that and meeting with legislators in the fall, getting ready for next January.
The hardest working man in the state of Iowa.
No.
In the church, right here. I have deemed him so. Tom Chapman, everyone, representing all four bishops for the state of Iowa, right there at the legislative branch here in Iowa. And we appreciate the work you're doing, man.
Hey, thank you,
John. On behalf of the church.
Hey, it's great to see you.
Amen. We're big fans of Tom here. We're always, always interested in what's happening, friends, and we should be. We should be involved, okay? Where can people go to learn more about
IowaCatholicConference.org.
IowaCatholicConference.org, and Tom is the executive director there. All emails go to him.
They do.
Send them away.
Yeah.
Thanks for tuning in today, everybody. Again, on Monday, we've got Eric Groth that's going to be on. I'm looking forward to catching up with him. Sean McAfee next week as well, which I look forward to. He's done some really good works on sacramental theology in the church. So we have set a pretty good week in store for you next week. Let's pray together. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Thanks for tuning in today, everybody. I'm John Leonetti. In the meantime, be confident in Christ's mercy and his love today.
The Catholic Morning Show is a production of the Iowa Catholic Radio Network. To hear this and other programs, visit iowacatholicradio.com or download the Iowa Catholic Radio app.